The next item of business is a debate on motion 7614 in the name of Miles Briggs on delivering the homes Scotland needs. I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Miles Briggs to speak too and to move the motion up to 7 minutes, please, Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Scotland has a critical shortage of housing. I think the first debate clearly outlined that. I don't think any parties across the Parliament, and from the amendments I see brought forward today, want to question that situation. In fact, Homes for Scotland have calculated that across all tenures, there have been an accumulated shortfall of over 110,000 new homes since SNP ministers came to power in 2007. That is their target for the next decade. That makes the drop in the number of new homes being started, reported by yesterday's housing statistics, even more worrying. And whilst the 1,806 increase in completions in the year to end of 2022 is welcome, this is more than offset by the 2,765 drop in the number of new homes started and will be further added by the housing crisis Scotland faces, as well as private-led new build starts decreasing by 15% in the year to the end of June. Social sector starts have also fallen by 16%. Yes.
Yep. Cabinet Secretary.
Miles Briggs has been meeting with the sector. He will have heard what I have heard, and that is the key issue for them is the rate of inflation and interest rates as well, but particularly the rate of inflation. Would Miles Briggs not acknowledge that is a major driver at the moment?
Miles Briggs.
And I think this is where these global commodity prices have been impacting. Certainly coming out of the pandemic, both steel and concrete have had a huge impact globally, not just in Scotland. They tell me, really, their major concern has been the Scottish Government's rent controls and the impact it's had on their sector. And I'm sure that's why the Minister, sitting beside the Cabinet Secretary, took the action to finally remove the sector from that piece of legislation. I welcome that, but I wish he'd listened to Conservative concerns at the time on that. Now, the Cabinet Secretary has spoken about peaks and troughs to the government meeting its housing targets. The concern is that all we are currently seeing is troughs, and I agree with what Willie Rennie has said in terms of delivering the homes that Scotland needs. Now, there is also a real and very real concern over the impact of what is the Scottish Government's current proposed budget cuts, especially on both the housing budgets and local government budgets, which are facing significant pressures. We are hearing that from every single councillor across Scotland. I don't know why the Scottish Government have decided to target the Cabinet Secretary's portfolios with such major cuts compared to other ministers, but the impact is going to be very real on being able to meet the housing targets of the future and a direct impact on key vital council services. Deputy Presiding Officer, the lack of new housing and affordable housing is a particular concern in rural and island communities. Last week, I visited Unionist along with the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, and the message that came across loud and clear from the islanders we met was that it is now critical for more affordable homes to be delivered in rural and island communities in order to meet the needs of key workers, and that without urgent action, depopulation was rapidly becoming a real issue once again. That was not also to mention the real anger at the devastating impact the ongoing delay to delivering the new ferries that the islands need to both their transport connections, but also these vulnerable communities. Scottish Conservatives have continually called for the doubling of the Scottish Government's Rural Housing Fund and to help incentivise construction in remote and rural communities. And I think that's something the government need to really listen to. And with regards to Colette Stevenson's points with the National Planning Framework, the reason why I felt we couldn't support it was that framework does not acknowledge what is a housing crisis in Scotland.
Exactly.
And that is something which the government needs to get real on. It doesn't provide the framework that many wanted to see in focusing delivering the new homes we desperately need to see brought forward in all sectors across Scotland. The situation for first-time buyers is also very concerning. Decisions taken by SNP and Green ministers to scrap Help to Buy schemes has made it harder for many young first-time buyers to even consider buying their future home. That's why Scottish Conservatives want to introduce our own rent-to-own scheme. This would allow tenants to buy their home and receive a percentage of their rent towards a deposit. Now, I hope that's something ministers will really take on board and look at the pressures facing many households and take that policy forward as soon as possible. But it is clear that ministers need to act and take into account the changing market. For example, allowing councils varying prices across Scotland and also raising the national LBTT threshold as well. Deputy Presiding Officer, we need to see a new approach from this Scottish Government. We all agree that we urgently need to see more social housing built. And I've met with the sector and know that there is real anger at how they have been treated by this government. But they want to look to a long-term solution to address the lack of affordable housing. More action is needed, and many members have mentioned this in terms of empty homes. Bringing these homes back into use is something the government have promised for many years, 15 years now, but we've not seen that progress. And I agree with the point made in the Labour amendment that urgent interventions are required to unlock these homes, but we just haven't seen them coming forward from this government. Deputy Presiding Officer, it is clear that there are very and real negative impacts on the horizon for our property market in Scotland. Surveys conducted by Scottish Land and Estates, Property Mark, Scottish Association of Landlords demonstrate that people are now looking at removing their private rented properties from the sector. 70% of agents report that landlords are deciding not to bring forward rental properties. Now, government ministers say that they agree that the private rented sector has a key part to play in ending homelessness and the housing crisis. Yet we have seen them attack that sector and we are seeing fewer homes coming forward. That crisis is only going to build as we head into the autumn. So to conclude, we have real concerns at what could be the collapse in the private rental market in Scotland, especially here in the capital, where supply is significantly decreasing at the very time that demand for housing is increasing. Ministers need to start heeding these warnings and act before it's too late. And I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. And before I call the Cabinet Secretary, could I just remind members to exercise quite a bit of caution in any references, direct or indirect, to the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022. As members have been advised, a petition for judicial review of that legislation has been lodged with the court, and the case is therefore considered to be active for the purposes of the sub judice rule. And I think members were provided with further information on that point. I would hope that all members would be very careful when making references to the issues at hand. I now call on Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and to move Amendment 7614.2. Up to 6 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I'll move the amendment in my name at the beginning. Can I just say how refreshing it was actually to hear the tone of Jamie Green's concluding speech? And wouldn't it be so much more productive if that was the tone that the Tories took in this chamber rather than just the constant attacks? It's all our fault. There's no positivity or solutions being brought forward. And I do think that something the Tories really need to reflect upon. And I come on to the point about empty homes, because Jamie Green mentioned the issue of empty homes, which is actually an important point. And of course, we have been taking action on empty homes, which has brought more than 8,259 homes back into use since 2010. But there's more to be done, without a shadow of a doubt. And of course, that is why we have made a commitment to look at the compulsory purchase powers. And we have made a commitment to look at modernising the compulsory purchase order process. I just wonder if the Tories will vote for or against those measures when they are brought forward, because I suspect that yet again will be a test of saying one thing in this chamber but then voting a completely different way when it comes to measures to actually resolve the problem.
I welcome measures to modernise the compulsory purchase process, in the awareness that councils don't have a lot of money to complete that compulsory purchase process. Will the government bring forward plans for compulsory sale orders so that local authorities could expedite empty homes back into use, but without the capital requirements of a compulsory purchase order.
So
the member, Matt Griffin, will be aware that we are considering the matter of compulsory sales orders as part of the review. But any new powers, of course, will need to be compliant with the European Convention of Human Rights. There are issues there that he will be more than aware of. Happy to speak to him separately in more detail about that. But you know, I'm keen to look at using all the levers we possibly can. And we have focused very much on the delivery of affordable homes, taking a world-leading approach to tackling homelessness and improving people's experiences of living in the rented sectors, and of course increasing our housing stock, albeit there of course is more to be done. And of course we brought an end to the Tory policy of right to buy back in 2016, a policy that saw over 500,000 social homes move out of the reach for people who would otherwise would have been able to access them. Our change to that policy has secured 15,000 homes over a decade that would otherwise have been lost from our housing stock. This government is aware that the economic mismanagement of the UK government has led to soaring inflation, spiralling energy bills and hardship, and that is of deep concern to this government, and we continue to urge the UK government to use the key levers that they hold. This government is providing almost £3 billion in this financial year that will help households face increased costs of living, including £1 billion only available here in Scotland. There are concrete actions that we're taking now to help people through the current crisis, but we are taking longer-term action to support people with their housing costs too. We have seen raging inflation, the damage to the labour supply and trade due to Brexit, surging energy prices, illegal war in Ukraine, all having a huge impact on the delivery of affordable housing, as anyone in the sector will tell anyone who wants to ask and listen. And it's in this context that we now work to deliver more affordable homes, and it is a very difficult backdrop without a doubt, but we remain committed to delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which 70% will be for social rent. That target will support a total investment package of around £18 billion and up to 15,000 jobs each year, while also making an important contribution to the economy, backed by £3.5 billion in this parliamentary term. So I don't think it's credible for anyone to say that we are not putting the resources in. And on the matter of resources, I would be surprised to have to tell anyone in this chamber that our capital budgets across the whole of the Scottish Government are impacted due to a 3.4% real terms cut by the UK Government. Our capital budgets depend on the UK Government's capital budgets. It's basic economics, Barnett consequentials. If there's a real terms cut to UK capital budgets, then our budgets are reduced. So budgets across the whole of the Scottish Government are reduced. But I set out in my speech earlier the measures we are taking to mitigate that 36.87 million or 4.7% reduction on the published capital spending review figure. The measures we are taking, a mixture of financial transactions, transfer from the Heat and Buildings Fund, donations from our charitable bond programme, in order to make sure that we keep that supply of funding coming through. And that is what we will continue to do. But the biggest impact, as anyone will tell you, is inflation. So this government will continuously review the impact of current inflationary pressures and market conditions on our capital programme. We will take the measures that we need to take. We have huge ambitions for housing in Scotland, set out in Housing to 2040, and we're working closely with local authorities, housing providers, landlords and the construction and house building sectors to achieve this. And I'm proud that our long-term housing strategy sets out a roadmap for how this government intends to deliver that Housing to 2040 vision, and will continue to work with others to translate that vision into action and reality.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Mark Griffin to speak to and move Amendment 7614.1. Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Again, we welcome this afternoon's second debate, and though there is much crossover with the previous debate, we're absolutely clear that the faltering house market in Scotland is as much a consequence of Tory economic chaos and mismanagement as it is to government inaction here. On that basis, we don't find ourselves in a position that we can support the government amendment or the Conservative motion at decision time, because the fact is that to get a home that a family can be proud of, one that is warm, safe, affordable, regardless of whether it is in the social sector, the private sector or owned, it is an uphill struggle for most, and for many their choices are limited to which tenure they can choose. That's because we aren't building enough and too many properties for which their primary purpose was to be someone's home are going unused or are used by wealthy individuals to accrue further wealth. Now, we do share the Conservatives' disappointment that the last target took an extra year to be met, and we agree that we need to build our way out of this housing crisis. But yesterday's statistics confirmed that starts are down across all tenures, with dire prospects for the years ahead. Homes for Scotland calculate that we are now 110,000 homes short of where we should be. And it's no wonder then there's practically no choice in the market. We've just had a debate about homelessness. But those declines in starts will mean greater shortfalls in the future. Now, the affordable housing pipeline is something that we should consider too, with approvals in the year to September down 1,400, starts down almost 2,000, and SFHA flagging that they believe the government isn't on track to meet its targets. Now, having questioned the government for months now about construction inflation and the suitability of benchmarks, I'm glad to see that the government now accepts that the construction inflation situation has meant a slowdown in some of the delivery projects. That's a start, that recognition is a start. But then what follows from that recognition is surely that a further review of the benchmark system is absolutely essential. But internally, government have known that the pipeline has been drying up. Its risk register on the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, which I obtained over the summer, shows that the affordable house building scheme is struggling. Every single issue was marked with a risk score higher than its target. Material shortages, underspends, rising tender prices, insufficient capital, slow approvals and starts, they're all flashing red on the government's own risk register. But the continued discussion about what the budget looks like for the year ahead, what it doesn't look like, and whether that's investment peaks and troughs or not, but Shelter are clear, they count it as a 16% cash cut. Spice say, comparing budgets like for like, it's a 12% drop in real terms, and capital grant is down 19%. Now, it doesn't matter where you take your figures from. Money's been lost from the building sector this year, and so we'll have less homes for the future. But it doesn't stop just at the overall budget, because there is another issue affecting local affordable housing supply, and that is the hike in the additional dwelling supplement announced in December, because councils will have to pay that while RSLs don't. Now, while we agree with the increase, we still feel that the government should bring forward measures to take that burden from local authorities. In my region, North Lanarkshire and Falkirk councils have been liable for average payments of between £3,000 and £5,000 for their purchase of off-the-shelf homes or off purchase from the market. Now, those sums will now increase by 50%. Now, I know that the government has consulted on exempting them, but 9 months on, that has to become a reality. That funding that the government puts in to build houses is actually coming back to government again on additional dwelling supplement rather than the primary purpose it was addressed. But in closing, Presiding Officer, I want to make clear that the Tories are absolutely not off the hook when it comes to this debate. I think even bringing this motion to Parliament does seem slightly blinkered. We all saw the Scottish Property Federation briefing that was issued last week, citing a £700 million loss of investment in the private rented sector. But we don't have short memories. It was clearly caused
by the disastrous...
Mr Griffin,
I will need you to bring your remarks to a close, please. Thank you.
It was clearly caused by the disastrous Conservative mini-budget that wiped billions of pounds off the value of the economy. And that's something that has to be borne in mind. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. And I now call on Willie Rennie. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Rennie.
Deputy President Officer, can I apologise for not being in at the conclusion of last debate? I got stuck into a very detailed discussion with Murdo Fraser about whisky, of all issues.
I don't think we need any more details, Mr Rennie. Thank you.
So, apologies for that. I just want to start off where Mark Griffin finished. I think, there's much of what Miles Briggs said in his opening contribution that I agreed with, but he can't ignore the direct impact on people's mortgages of the Liz Truss budget. A 10% increase in payments has blown a hole in many people's finances. On a typical budget, it could mean an extra £1,800 a year. That's the context that we're living in just now. And so I think it'd be right for Miles Briggs to reflect on that. I know he was embarrassed by the budget, as many Conservatives were, but that is the context, that is the environment. And we are, when young people in particular are facing a real challenge in even just raising a deposit to buy their own home, we have a massive intergenerational problem in terms of housing. Many people, older people, have got access to property, but younger people can't even think about it. I mean, I bought my first home when I was 25. Many people don't see themselves ever getting their own home. So again, that's the context. And we've also, I think the Minister is right to identify the huge challenges in terms of inflation and costs, but also skills in the sector and access to land, because some house builders are finding it very difficult to access land. And this ties into the NPF4 debate that we had at the end before Christmas, where there is a real emphasis on trying to get brownfield sites and properties above shops utilised. But these are not cheap to do. They are costly. Otherwise, they would have been developed by now. So we need to look at what incentives there are by the government to make that happen. And the more we put into that, the more challenging it is to meet our overall other targets. So we need to get the balance right between brownfield and greenfield. There's great pressure to build more houses, and I think we need to provide the right incentives from government. But the wider policy environment is what I'm concerned about. We are in a state of massive flux. We've had a range of pieces of legislation over recent years in terms of short-term lets, the 2016 Act, the Coronavirus Acts, the emergency rent cap before Christmas, and we've supported all of those measures. We didn't support the short-term let licensing, but we did support the control areas. And on top of that, landlords have seen the UK with the landlord tax relief changes having a direct impact on their investments that they're making. So we are in a state of flux just now. We've got many reports of landlords evacuating the sector. And before we move on to the next stage of proposed changes around about perhaps rent controls, I would like us to see the evidence of what the current legislation impact is on the housing sector. Because if young people can't get into a property off their own, we need to make sure there is a healthy private rented sector. And all the jungle drums are that it's not healthy just now, that landlords, good people who are providing good homes for people, are finding it difficult to sustain their private properties, and they're leaving the sector. So we may be at a tipping point, and I want to make sure that the government is listening and watching and reading all the evidence before we go further with any proposed rent controls. Because I've heard and I've seen the evidence about the impact that rent controls can have in terms of the lack of investment and disinvestment from the private rented sector, the evidence from other countries. So I want to make sure that we've got the evidence before we make the next step. But one final plea is I would like the government to put more emphasis on the Community Housing Trust and the Rural Housing Burden Opportunity. It would be particularly beneficial to areas like the East Newark and Fife, where working people find it really hard to have their own home close to their place of work. This may be part of the answer, not the whole answer, but part of the answer. and I hope the government can put greater emphasis on that in future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. And we now move to the open debate. Speeches of up to 4 minutes. I call Graham Simpson to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Mr Simpson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. We don't debate housing often enough in this place, so to get two debates in one day is really good. Perhaps it's not seen as exciting enough, I don't know. A debate on housing targets probably isn't going to grab any headlines. Even very worthy things like Alex Rowley's attempt to have all new homes built to passive house standards don't really cut through. But housing affects us all. We all need somewhere to live, and there are wildly varying standards of accommodation in this country. Solve the cold homes problem with top-notch insulation, and you help to solve the fuel poverty crisis. If our old folk can live in warm homes that cost very little to heat, they'll have a better life. We all would, actually. And solve the tenement maintenance problem, as some of us in this Parliament are trying to do, and you solve the issue of people living in poor conditions in many of our towns and cities. Housing matters to our health and well-being, mental and physical. And so delivering the homes we need is one of the most important things we can do. But when you have 47,000 homeless people and 21,000 households in temporary accommodation, but 67,000 unoccupied properties in Scotland, then something is wrong. And when the number of households in temporary accommodation has gone up since Nicola Sturgeon came to power, then you have to question her priorities. Presiding Officer, I've got to give the SNP some praise. They are consistent. They've repeatedly missed their house building targets. They told us that 50,000 affordable homes will be built in the last Parliament. Well, they were built, but a year late. They've missed their target to build homes in the social rented sector, and in the recent National Planning Framework 4, there was scant reference to housing targets. Homes for Scotland say we need 100,000 new homes after years of undersupply. Well, they always say we need more, it's their business to do that, but I don't hear anyone contesting the figures. We know this, we've known it for years, but we don't do anything about it. We need a homes delivery agency tasked with the job of helping and cajoling councils to hit targets with the right homes in the right places. Right now, we're just tinkering around the edges. Not only that, we have a government that actively damages the housing sector. Patrick Harvey's rent controls are going to lead to fewer homes being available for rent, less investment in those that remain, and ultimately higher rents. You couldn't make it up. I just wish I had, but it's true. We'll see students struggling to find somewhere to live. We already are. We should be encouraging firms, yes, private firms, to build more homes for rent, not putting barriers in their way. And we should be dealing with the problem of empty homes by having compulsory sales orders. That used to be SNP policy, but it's obviously ended up in that mountainous, too difficult pile. Deputy Presiding Officer, I'll go back to where I started. Housing matters. It affects us all. It's too important to let ideologues loose on it. Sometime soon, reality is going to have to kick in. I support the motion in the name of Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Mr Simpson. I now call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Ms Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm surprised to see the Conservatives bring this debate forward today, when it's their government in Westminster which is directly impacting the Scottish Government's ability to build new homes and to tackle inequality. It is the capital spending decisions of the Tory UK Government that have led to such difficult choices being made in this year's draft budget. The Scottish Government saw a 3.4% real terms reduction in its capital allocation for housing between the financial years 2023 and 2024 as a result of the decisions taken in Westminster. Frustratingly, the falling capital grant allocation that Scotland has received, along with the relentless inflation and cost pressures, has reduced the buying power of the Scottish Government's ambitious housing investment. In anticipation of difficult financial circumstances, a reduction has already been identified in the capital spending review. Without full fiscal levers of an independent state, difficult decisions have had to be made. Despite the challenge of UK government's austerity, Scotland's five-year £3.5 billion commitment on the affordable housing supply programme remains. The Scottish Government's £752 million investment for 2023-24 represents progress towards that £3.5 billion pledge. Additionally, and in the most challenging budget settlement since devolution, the Scottish Government is providing more than £13.2 billion to help support councils and communities to meet their housing needs. Inflationary pressures and market conditions will continue to affect the capital investment programme, but the Scottish Government has been clear that this will be monitored. A different approach to that of the Tory UK Government is possible. Unlike Westminster, the SNP-led Scottish Government is using all the levers at its disposal to maximise housing investment to the benefit of people and the economy. Our ministers have already laid out how they are targeting public spending as effectively as possible. As affordable housing remains a key priority, the Scottish Government plans to mitigate the near £37 million reduction in its housing budget from Westminster with a £15 million in-year transfer from the Heat and Building Strategy budget to help to fund zero-emissions heating systems, with charitable bond donations that will be directed towards investment in social rented homes and with further financial transactions. Presiding Officer, the Tory motion complains that the Scottish Government has not met its housing building targets. However, the Scottish Government remains fully committed to delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032. Over 113,000 affordable homes have already been delivered since 2007 by the SNP in government. Since 2007, the annual average supply of affordable housing per head of population in Scotland has been 13.9 homes per 10,000 population. It's the highest in the UK. This is higher than England, who have delivered just 9.7 homes per 10,000, higher than Wales, 8 homes per 10,000, and higher than Northern Ireland, 13
the
homes per 10,000.
The members in our last 30 seconds.
For the new target of 110,000, 4,927 affordable homes have been delivered. Indeed, this SNP Scottish Government have a track record to be proud of. The previous 50,000 affordable homes target was met in March 2022, a year late, but we've had a pandemic. And this has been reducing inequality by providing more warm, safe, high-quality places to live, including within my Aberdeen Donside constituency. In closing, Presiding Officer, SNP Scottish Government, which is acting to build homes, tackle inequality and to better the lives of the people of Scotland.
Thank you. I now call for, we have no time in hand. I call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Liz Smith. Mr Chowdhury, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thank you for the opportunity to speak on this important issue. My casework is inundated with constituents experiencing housing issues, whether this be caused by waiting lists for permanent family homes being offered unsuitable temporary accommodation or suffering the effect of mould and dump in the social housing. I'm very concerned that the allocation for housing in the Scottish Government proposed 23-24 budget will only make this housing crisis worse. We need to address these problems head on. If funding is not allocated to the housing budget for the building of new homes, the Scottish Government will be hard pushed to reach its own affordable housing targets. Further cuts to local governments also mean that local councils cannot attempt to tackle this housing crisis. The creation of new homes in crucial to solving the catastrophic which is currently unfolding in our housing sector. The reduction in housing investments can be directly attributed to the UK government's disastrous mini-budget and at a step raise to, in interest rates as a result. Scottish Labour supports a rent freeze and eviction ban to help tenants during the cost of living crisis. While we recognise that this is not a long-term solution to the housing crisis, ending restrictions on rent and eviction would only further exacerbate this crisis, with an estimated 14,250 households who experienced core homelessness in 2021. Shockingly, an estimate 13,000 children may not sleep in their own homes tonight. New housing must be built to try and tackle this evolving problem, and the Scottish Government must increase funding to local authorities in its 2023-24 budget to deliver vital homelessness service. Edinburgh Council alone is facing a £65 million bill to tackle homelessness, and local authorities across Scotland will also be buckling under the weight of the overflowing housing sector. New and existing homes must also be brought to standard to ensure that they are energy efficient and can protect tenants against mould and damp. I have recently raised this issue in a motion to the Parliament, and I am very worried that without action, housing across Scotland is putting our constituents in danger. Damp housing disproportionately affects those living in poverty, and the cost of living crisis has forced people to avoid heating their homes. This has simply made the problem worse. New homes need to be provided, but we need to ensure that these houses are energy efficient, insulated, and most importantly, affordable for those who need them most. This must be a priority for the Scottish Government. The housing crisis cannot be resolved if not. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call Liz Smith to be followed by Christine Graham. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Smith.
Thank you. My colleague Graham Simpson quite rightly said that housing policy is extremely important, and it certainly is. And I want to concentrate on the economic and geographical mobility aspect of this policy, because that is absolutely critical when we are looking at the future. And that's because there is extensive evidence in several quarters that the SNP's current housing policy is hindering that mobility that we so desperately need. Indeed, the Deputy First Minister has quite rightly said on several occasions in this chamber that the biggest challenge for the Scottish budget in future years is Scotland's demographic profile, and most especially the diminishing size of the working population in relation to the total population, with the knock-on effects, of course, that has for productivity and tax take. So it is surely important that the policy decisions on housing do everything possible to address these issues and the likely behavioural changes amongst the public. For example, and this is something that has been exercising the Finance Committee for some weeks now, the Scottish Government has made it very clear that there are two intentions behind the proposal to increase the tax rate on the additional dwelling supplement from 4% to 6%, namely to raise revenue and to protect first-time buyers. Now, that's all well and good in principle, but as the Scottish Fiscal Commission has said, landlord associations, local authorities have all said, there is potential for significant behavioural change as a result of this policy, and here's why. In many parts of Scotland, the only people who are buying and modernising properties are private landlords, and that includes empty houses being brought back into use. And that's extremely important activity, especially in our rural communities, which are already at risk of depopulation, and where we very much need farm and rural sector workers. And there's also the need to promote the tourism market, and that's a market that Scotland can ill afford to undermine. Landlord associations are now complaining that 44% of their members are already intending to reduce their portfolios. That is very serious indeed for Scotland. And yes, that's true that it's income for some of these landlords. From a general economic perspective, it matters to ensure that there is better housing stock and it also encourages a more mobile workforce, which Scotland so desperately needs to improve productivity and geographical mobility. Because if Scotland is to be truly open for business, then housing policy has to play a critical role. Now, my colleagues have spoken about the recent rent freeze and cited the reaction from several stakeholders, not surprising given that the Scottish Government's inability to justify the different approaches to the rent cap in the social housing and private rented sector. Critics make the case about the inflexibility of this policy, that the rent control applies irrespective of the financial positions of the tenant and the landlord, and that a relatively well-off tenant who is renting in the private sector is provided with the financial protection that is not afforded to someone less well-off in the social sector. That doesn't make sense. John Blackwood of the Scottish Association of Landlords quite rightly makes the point that the rent freeze and eviction policy means that many landlords are, not surprisingly, selling up on loss-making properties, further reducing the housing supply at a time when demand is increasing. And he points out that local authority and housing associations can put up rents in order to make repairs and improvements, failing to acknowledge that private landlords face exactly the same challenges. And of course, we had that ridiculous situation at Glasgow University a few months ago, which, because of the difficulties with getting suitable rented property, they were actually telling students that they would be best not to enrol for their education courses until they found accommodation. That is hardly an acceptable situation. Presiding officer, I don't doubt housing policy is complex, particularly when it comes to matching supply with demand, but neither do I doubt that the current SNP interferences in market forces are making things a whole lot worse. They are forcing detrimental behaviour change, with the same result that stakeholders who have been relied upon to help the housing market are now being forced out. That is not good for Scotland or the ambitions to achieve long-term growth.
Thank you, Ms Smith. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's a basic human right to have a place to call home. It provides shelter, comfort, a sanctuary, an identity. You have your own address. This is where I live. But now there will be increased pressures on people to keep what home they have, meeting that mortgage payment with interest rates soaring as well as energy and food bills. We need more socially affordable homes, yes, but consider the following factors, all impacting on the cost of constructing houses. Inflation. That 10% inflation stems directly from the economic failures of the UK government. It has reduced the actual value of the Scottish Government budget, set when it was 3% inflation, by some £1.4 billion, which means that housing budget, referred to by the Cabinet Secretary, buys even less in the market. Brexit. After the nigh stagnation of construction in the 2 years of COVID, demand for construction materials is extremely high, but there's a supply chain issue. One reason for the shortage of construction materials is the fact that lorry drivers in the country are in short supply. This means it's become more expensive to deliver construction materials to different parts of the UK, therefore more expensive to build. A large number of lorry drivers in the UK were from EU countries, and many of them cannot come back here. According to the Construction Leadership Council, 60% of imported materials used in construction are from the European Union. The supply of timber has especially been affected by Brexit, as 80% to 90% of softwood is imported from European countries. Scarcity again adds to construction costs. Skills shortage. It's worth noting that it is estimated that close to 1 million construction workers are set to retire in the next 10 years. And this again will significantly impact the industry. Before Brexit, about 40% of all construction workers in the UK came from other EU countries. Now such workers are unlikely to get visas to work here as the UK has introduced a points-based system. The impact of the skills shortage in the UK is that employers will have to increase wages as competition will be stiff amongst the companies, all putting up construction costs. Then there's VAT. I quote Rishi Sunak for the first and possibly the last time. Greenbelt land is extremely precious in the UK. We've seen too many examples of local councils circumventing the views of residents, by taking land out of Greenbelt for development, but I will put a stop to it. Close quote. Yet VAT for construction on brownfield sites remains in some cases at 17.5% and in other circumstances at 20%, while it's 0% on greenfield sites. Well, perhaps Mr Sunak's attention is occupied on other taxing matters, because nothing has happened on VAT equity to date. All of these, Brexit, inflation, VAT, add to the costs of construction of homes, especially in the socially rented sector, where councils are already under pressure because they have inflation on all fronts attacking their budgets. None of this is in the control of the Scottish Government, or reserved. So let's have some refreshing honesty from the Tory benches, starting perhaps with agreeing that VAT for construction on brownfield sites should be levied at 0%. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Arianne Burgess to be followed by Paul McLennan.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, the need for affordable, energy-efficient homes continues to be a central topic in the Highlands and Islands, so I welcome this opportunity to highlight the progress being made. Across Scotland, people struggle to find a home where they want to live and often face unaffordable rents and inadequate accommodation. And that's why the Bute House Agreement commits the Scottish Government to building, as we've heard already, 110,000 further homes by 2030, with 11,000 in rural areas. But there's no point in trying to fill the bath with the plug out. Scotland was right to end the right to buy in 2016, which led to the loss of 500,000 social homes, many of them now being let out by private landlords at two or three times the rent. The Tories would have us continue with that right to buy. In rural areas especially, we lose homes to the holiday and second homes market. The Scottish Government has been right to regulate and introduce stricter planning rules on short-term lets, again opposed by the Tories. It is also right to discuss with COSLA the reforms to council tax on second and empty homes and to make changes to the additional dwelling supplement, also, you guessed it, opposed by the Tories. Presiding Officer, there are a range of practical challenges to the delivery of rural homes, including the lack of skills trade, a shortage of planning staff, and the rise of cost of materials. Last week, I visited the Merchant's House in Inverness, an example of what can be done to repurpose and retrofit older buildings to make them energy efficient and sustainable for the future. The renovation, supported by the Scottish Government funding, has created high quality, affordable homes. This approach, making the most of the embodied energy in our existing housing stock, would be helped immensely if the Conservative UK Government revised its position on VAT in relation to retrofitting buildings. Presiding Officer, we need to look at where well-placed, affordable homes in our rural communities could create an opening for young people and families to stay or settle. To that end, I'm working to ensure that there is support from the Scottish Government for rural housing enablers like the Community Housings Trust, who help rural communities build the housing they desperately need. The Communities Housing Trust is currently working on 600 projects across approximately 150 communities, predominantly in rural Scotland, but a lack of funding certainty for their early stage work, building confidence and capacity in communities, and that's also the work for other housing enablers, is hampering project development and putting much needed rural homes at risk. Presiding Officer, enabling our housing ambitions requires resources. Over the course of this Parliament, we will deliver a mechanism for capturing, for public benefit, a share of the increase in land value that occurs when a development is supported through the planning system. It will take time for us to see the benefit of these actions, but all of them will increase the number of homes of the right type in the right place and make best use of homes we have. It is vital that homes are affordable. That is why the Bute House Agreement commits us to rent controls and why we consulted on that in the New Deal, far ahead of anywhere else in the UK. In the short term, we've taken emergency action to limit rent rises during the cost of living crisis, again, far ahead of anywhere in the UK. I challenge the assertion that regulation means declining supply and reduced investment. Neither is true in Germany, where there has been the largest rented sector in Europe, but also one of the most regulated. In closing, what Scotland's housing sector needs is long-term solutions and a culture change away from housing being seen as an investment to one that creates homes for people.
Thank you, and I call Paul McLennan, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a pleasure to speak in this debate this afternoon. 4 minutes is a short speech to talk about an incredibly important subject. Having been a councillor for 15 years, like many councillors in here, the biggest issue I had to deal with was housing, be that new homes, homelessness or repairs. Council housing sell-offs in the Thatcher era proved to be a disaster for Scottish social rented sector stock. East Lothian lost 8,000 houses. 8,000 houses in that period. It's been in recovery since then. The Scottish Government acted on the right to buy in 2016, and rightfully so. Despite the challenge of the UK Government's austerity, Scotland's five-year £3.5 billion commitment and affordable housing programme remains. The Scottish Government, and I'll repeat it again, is fully committed to delivering 110,000 affordable houses by 2032. And we've heard before, 70% will be available for social rent and 10% will be in our rural and island communities. The previous 50,000 affordable homes was met in March 22 and obviously was delayed due to COVID. And obviously that provides warm, safe, high-quality places to live. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned about the 3.4% real terms reduction in its capital allocation for housing between 22-23 and 2024. And make no doubt, this is a result of decisions taken in Westminster based on the disastrous trust quartering economic experiment. We've just seen that now. UK borrowing, government borrowing is at a record high. It's now, national debt is now at £2.5 trillion. There is always going to be peaks and troughs of investment towards this goal. The Scottish Government, as I said, a £752 million investment for 2023 represents progress towards the £3.5 billion pledge. Now, we've heard around about the housing market slowing down. I've spoken to Homes for Scotland only just last week and other house builders in terms of that. The biggest impact on just why the market's slowing down is interest rates due to Tory government incompetence. It's due to interest rate rises. People aren't investing in that. Scotland has very limited capital borrowing powers compared with other small independent countries similar to us in size. Now, colleagues in the local government and social justice and social security committees know that in this area, I would like to see Scotland be given more extensive borrowing powers. That could be done within the current devolved setup and has been discussed with ongoing fiscal framework discussions between the Scottish and UK governments and the Cabinet Secretary. I asked on that last week as well. Yet, Labour and Tory colleagues and committees won't support that additional borrowing power. So I would urge the UK Government to be as flexible as it can in this regard. Investment in housing will bolster economic growth and provide more jobs. As I said, another fallout of the trust economic disaster is high inflation rates. The UK has the highest rate apart in the G7, apart from Italy, and is one of the worst in the G20. We've heard about inflation and pressure feeding through to construction costs. Inflation is at 10.5%. The briefing we received today from Homes for Scotland mentioned that the report of construction tender price index is at 22%, not 10.5%, 22%. Now, coming back to say the Scottish Government is committed to fully delivering 110,000 by 2022, and that is despite rampant inflation. Christine Graham talked about the impact of Brexit around about current supply issues. Only today, Mark Carney, the ex-Governor at Bank of England Governor, stated, and I quote, "The UK is in the most difficult position of all the major world economies due to Brexit." That's a direct quote. Across the 15 years between 2007-08 and 2021-22, the annual average supply of affordable housing was at 13.9 homes per 10,000. And I'm not going to repeat the point that Jackie Dunbar made in terms of that as well. Now, being a member of the Local Government Committee, we have, like the Parliament, we've been discussing NPF4 and how we can support that home building. So we will be monitoring the targets in terms of 110,000, but also be looking at other things such as the Honda process, the Matlab process, empty homes and other funding models in terms of that. In terms of planning as well, I know the Minister, Tom Arthur, is engaging with ministers with the RTPI to deliver the 700 planners that's required. The Scottish Government is delivering in extremely difficult circumstances and is working with partners such as Homes for Scotland and RTPI to build as many houses as it can across all tenures. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches and I call on Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I stated earlier in the debate, the causes of lack of housing and the homelessness crisis is something that has to be borne by both governments. The disastrous mini-budget will have long-lasting effects on Scotland's housing market, both on the social and private sectors and beyond, which is unforgivable. And their failed economic experiment will only be made worse, though, by continued government action here, though. Well, only a couple of weeks ago, during the debate on MPF4, government again dismissed concerns that the all 10-year housing land calculations actively exclude tens of thousands of young households from the numbers needing the bill, and then the autumn voted down Labour proposals to help mortgagers struggling with a revamped scheme with lower equity requirements and increased thresholds reflecting current prices. Now, a frustration that I have had this afternoon is that neither the Conservative nor the Government motion and amendments offer an idea for travel. They offer no policy proposals, no changes that could be implemented that would support change. Now, we have had backbench contributions. My regional colleague Graeme Simpson highlighted compulsory sales order. My Labour colleague Faisal Chowdhury suggested a course of action on dampness. Christine Graham, Ariane Burgess talking about reform to the VAT that should be introduced by the UK Government. Paul McLennan talking about changes that we would seek as a committee on NPF4. But there doesn't seem to be that direction of travel to drive forward policy change, either from the Conservatives front bench or the government. And that's why we see a clear and urgent need for a dedicated housing minister. Now, no, this is nowhere near a criticism or a motion of no confidence, but the minister has parliamentary responsibilities, you know, in the words of Burns today, as long as my arm. The cabinet secretary has an entry that includes local government, that includes the devolution of a whole range of social security powers, who has no doubt had her time taken up by a gender recognition reform bill. There is clearly a desire within the housing sector, amongst builders and amongst the third sector, to see a more focused government policy on housing, and would like to see a dedicated minister leading that. Now, I also spoke in the last debate about how grant guidance rules require open market acquisitions and therefore vacant possessions, requiring sellers to make tenants homeless. And in the context of the debate, what that also means is that purchases with a tenant in situ are all but ruled out by the supply programme. Councils and RSL's choice is limited to a property where a tenant may have either been made or threatened with homelessness, and it's an area I would like the government to look at and urgently see if changes can be made to protect tenants from homelessness and still allowing social sector acquisitions. And I know the Cabinet Secretary made an attempt to intervene on me on a previous debate on that, and I'm happy to take an intervention on social sector acquisitions from the private sector with a tenant in situ if the government has any announcements they want to make.
The member is in his final 10 seconds.
I will update the member because it is an important point, and I have raised it with COSLA, and I hope to make progress.
Ever so briefly.
Thank you, President. There's a whole range of issues that I hope that we can get our teeth into in a further housing debate. This is the start of a substantive discussion and debate on housing, you know, rather than Labour bringing forward proposals and either being voted down or repackaged a couple of months later by the government. But I thank members for their consideration today and ask them to support the amendment in my name.
Thank you. And I now call on Patrick Harvey, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm not sure I can quite express my relief at being told by Mark Griffin that it's not actually a motion of no confidence that he's bringing. I do hope, given the importance that we all attach to housing policy, I do hope that members will stay focused on the policy the government is pursuing rather than whose name is on which door, because I do think that there is more common ground between us than is sometimes recognised. The importance of housing policy has been recognised by members across the spectrum, and I believe that the importance of housing policy is written right through the Housing to 2040 strategy, that long-term vision for housing in Scotland, as well as the housing elements of the Programme for Government and the Bute House Agreement, which build on that long-term vision. I won't have time, Presiding Officer, to address all the issues that have been raised today, but supply has, of course, been critical. Not only the extent of supply, but the nature of supply. Several members have raised issues such as rurality, and of course the existing commitment to deliver 110,000 affordable homes by 2032 includes at least 10% of those for remote rural and island communities, including through our demand-led rural housing fund, as well as the Remote Rural and Island Housing Action Plan that will bolster that work. And like Arianne Burgess, I also want to recognise the importance of community housing bodies in delivering that work. The nature of supply is also about accessibility and the work that we're taking forward to streamline the adaptation system, as well as reviewing housing for varying needs, which will lead to changes to building standards. I give way.
Miles Briggs.
The member mentions supply. Does the minister believe that there will be more or fewer private rented properties in Scotland this autumn?
Minister.
I was about to come on to extent of supply after initially talking about the nature of supply. And the extent of supply is, of course, critical. It's been raised by a number of members. I think it's worth just recognising something of the track record here. The 2,500 plus affordable homes that were completed in the latest quarter to September 2022 brings the total number completed in the 12 months prior to that to 9,449. Now, that is only an increase of 2% on the previous year, but against the backdrop that we all recognise of extraordinary inflation pressures, as well as the lack of comparable action that we've seen from the UK government, I think any increase in that last year is significant. I'm not for a moment, and nor would the Cabinet Secretary, going to wish away or pretend that we don't face continual ongoing challenges. But I know that some members don't like when Scottish ministers compare our track record to that of the UK government, but let's just recognise that in the 4 years leading up to 21-22, Scotland didn't just see a marginal improvement on what's happening in England. 59% more affordable homes delivered per head of the population than in England, and over nine times as many social rented homes delivered per head of the population than in England. Scotland does have a strong track record. We also have challenges to continue to deliver on that track record. And I know that members have debated the budget and different interpretations of the budget. The Cabinet Secretary has laid out very clearly, I think, how we will continue to strain every sinew to make sure that we fund that long-term commitment of £3.5 billion being made available for the affordable housing programme over the course of this Parliament. But I would take criticisms a little bit more seriously from Conservative members if even one of them, if even one Conservative member, since that ideological experiment of the mini-budget from the Truss Kwarteng temporary government, if any one of them had argued that the UK government should be inflation-proofing the Scottish government's block grant so that we're protected from the harm that's been done by that. I've been accused, I think, by Mr Simpson of being an ideologue during this debate. The most ideological actions that we've seen that have impacted on our ability to deliver affordable housing have come from the UK government, not from this one. But I want to finish, Presiding Officer, by saying that this is about more than just supply. There are those ideologues who think that the free market will deliver everything. I don't believe that a deregulated free market will deliver housing as a human right for people. I think we need the action of government and the action that we're taking forward. I know that I'm limited in what I can say about recent legislation, and I regret that I can't respond directly to points made by some members who choose not to respect those limits that we were warned about at the start of the debate. But we are clear on the need to protect people from high rents and to ensure that people have security of tenure. What we're seeing
in Scotland, Minister,
is a continued commitment to ensure that the housing system meets everybody's needs, our human right to adequate housing, security of tenure, as well as affordability. And that is what we'll continue to do.
Thank you. And I call on Murdo Fraser to wind up the debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by reminding people of my register of interests in that I own a share in two properties which are let on the private rental market. Well, we've had two debates this afternoon, Presiding Officer, two very helpful debates, which have exposed the dismal track record of this government in terms of housing. And let's look at the facts. Homelessness is on the increase. The number of children in temporary accommodation has doubled in the last 8 years. 100,000 children today on social housing waiting lists. At least 24,000 people with disabilities on waiting lists. A real terms cut in the housing budget by £215 million, a failure to meet the affordable homes target on time, a housing gap now of 110,000 new homes, according to Homes for Scotland, as Miles Briggs reminded us. And the only excuse we hear from the government benches is to say it's all down to inflation. It's all down to inflation, completely ignoring the fact, it seems, that in the Eurozone we have inflation pretty much equivalent to what we have in the UK. Indeed, back in the month of November, inflation in the Eurozone was actually higher than it was in the UK. How that's down to Liz Truss is beyond me, but maybe Mr Harvey can explain.
I'm pleased that Mr Fraser is such a fan of the Eurozone and of our European colleagues, such as Germany, with a decades-long system of rent controls and a stronger and larger rented sector than we have in this country. Isn't that evidence enough that we can do a great deal better than the deregulated free market approach he advocates?
I noticed Mr Harvey couldn't respond to the inflation point, but I would say to him gently about Germany, take a trip to Berlin, Mr Harvey, and you'll see what rent controls have done to destroy the availability of the private rented sector there. And lastly, on the inflation point, Presiding Officer, even if there is an issue with inflation in the current year, that doesn't excuse the last 14 years of failure from this government when they were in charge of housing in Scotland. So we believe, Presiding Officer, that housing should be a priority for this government. But the sad thing is, the interventions it is bringing forward are making matters worse. Well, yes, I will, if the Minister's brief.
Cabinet Secretary. Can he describe delivery of 115,550 affordable homes as failure since 2007? And also, does he agree with the Daily Express? First-time buyers get the biggest leg up in the Scottish market. Are these not things that he should be praising rather than criticising?
Murdo Fraser.
The Minister hasn't been listening to all the statistics in this debate about the rise in homelessness, the rise in people on social housing waiting lists, the 110,000 gap that's been identified by Homes for Scotland. She needs to listen to what's actually happening out there. Now, we heard about the private rented sector from Graeme Simpson and Liz Smith. It's important. It's important for social mobility. Not everybody can afford to or wants to buy a house. Not everybody can get access to the social rented sector. So we need a vibrant private rented sector. And the reality is the choices made by this government are delivering a rapid reduction in supply as a direct consequence of the Minister's choices. And I thought it was really interesting. Patrick Harvey did not respond to Miles Briggs' intervention about the decline in supply of the private rented sector, because what we hear is that there has already been a 29% fall in the number of properties in the private rented sector since 2016. £700 million of residential investment has been paused. Landlords are selling up, as every letting agent will tell you. And the real terms, the real life impact of this is that in the city that Mr Harvey represents, Glasgow, the university was telling students back in September to give up their courses at the university because they could not get accommodation. That is shameful, Mr Harvey. I'm sorry, I don't have time for another intervention at this particular point. And we have a minister who doesn't understand the sector, and if he engaged with it, he would realise his interventions are causing a greater problem. The international evidence tells us that rent controls, whether introduced in Dublin or in Berlin or in Sweden, what they do is cause a mismatch between supply and demand. They lead to long waiting lists, they lead to a reduction in social mobility, and they lead to illegal subletting. That is what happens if you bring in rent controls. Mr Harvey, is a huge error. And let's look at the owner-occupied secretary. And we have a problem. Willie Rennie identified this, and I forgive Mr Rennie for trying to blame me for his tardy re-arrival at the previous debate. When Mr Rennie and I, who I think are of a similar vintage, bought our first homes in our 20s, now the average age of a first-time buyer is, I think, 37 in Scotland. Property is increasingly unaffordable. We need more homes. We need more homes because we have a growing population. We have more people living on their own. We have a population shift in Scotland from west to east. So places like the Lothians, like Fife, like Aberdeenshire, like Tayside, need more properties, and we aren't building enough homes. We need to look at the excessive delays in getting planning. In the National Planning Framework debate 3 weeks ago, Fergus Ewing, I don't think he's in the chamber, sadly, made an excellent speech about relaxing planning rules to allow farmers and estates more opportunity to build more housing, provide the opportunities, provide the economic benefit from more house building, driving the economy forward. That's the sort of intervention we should be listening to, presiding officer. So we've got solutions on this side of the chamber. Reform of the planning system, relaxing rules to allow the redevelopment of commercial properties into residential. The rent-to-buy scheme, Miles Briggs talked about. Reform of LBTT, action to bring empty homes into use. These are the things the Scottish Government should be doing instead of its dismal record. Presiding officer, we have a crisis in housing. We have too much demand chasing too little supply. And the answer is to increase the supply, both in the owner-occupied sector and in the private rented sector, and indeed in the social rented sector. The policy choices of this government are going in the wrong direction. They're making the problem worse. That's why we need change, and that's why we need to support the motion in the name of Miles Briggs.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on delivering the homes Scotland needs. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 7615 in the name of Mary McCallan on Genetic Technology Precision Breeding Bill, UK legislation. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Mary McCallan to speak to and move the motion up to 7 minutes, Minister. I'll give you a moment or two.